Hello, CUBE community. Welcome back to Black Hat 2025 at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Jackie McGuire, your practice lead and principal analyst for security and favorite security media host. And I am thrilled to be joined by two of my favorite people from Wiz today. We have Hillai Ben Sasson and Andres Riancho. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us.
Thank you.
Did I get the pronunciation right?
You nailed it.
It's a miracle. All right, so it's been a handful of days of Black Hat, so we're all running on fumes right now, so everybody be gentle. But I would love to start out with, you guys have done some really, really awesome things in the last couple of months, and I want to start out with, you know, maybe both of you give a little introduction and how you ended up at Wiz, and then we'll go into Black Hat stuff.
Right. Yeah. So, hi, I'm Hillai, and Wiz is actually my first job, believe it or not, but I've always been into cybersecurity, whether it was like a hobby as a little kid. We're not going to talk about the things that I did when I was a little kid, but you can believe me. but it's always been a hobby, and I actually got to Wiz with some shared friends that I met back in the Army. They pulled me in, and I was like, yeah, that sounds amazing. I'm in. Yeah, Wiz has been amazing ever since. We're doing some very interesting research with some great people. And awesome. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Andres, how about you?
I've been in cybersecurity for a couple of decades, so I'm a little bit older than my friend here.
Yeah, same. It's okay. It's all right. We're seasoned. That's
yeah.
All.
Yeah, of course. More experience.
Like fine wine.
Yeah, exactly.
And I have an application security background. Then I transitioned into cloud security. And now we have been doing a little bit of AI research in the last 6-9 months. So that's my background. And I joined Wiz almost a year and a half ago.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. All right. So I know you guys are going to talk a little bit about some research and stuff that you've done around AI. But I thought we'd talk about Black Hat. So I'm sure you've had lots of overstimulating conversations. I am about all peopled out this week, but what are the kind of key themes that you've pulled out in your conversations, you know, with customers, with other vendors? Because I think the sentiment is definitely shifting. So what are some of the more interesting things you've heard?
So I think that everyone really likes to talk about AI security, but I think that everyone also has like a different definition of AI security, right? Like, yeah. I think that it's kind of all over the place, and people are like, everyone has a different definition for what AI security means for them. And I think that what we've kind of zeroed in on when we try to figure out what AI security really is with examples is that AI security is just infrastructure security. Like, it's not some groundbreaking new thing that everyone invented from the ground up. It's the same sort
of
thing.
Python and APIs,
it's
right?
It's Python, it's API. But no, this time it's not an API, it's an MCP.
It's an MCP.
A totally different thing. But yeah. It really is the same thing. And mistakes that people did when they introduced APIs, now they're doing them again when they're introducing MCPs.
Yeah.
So I think it's kind of this sort circle of life of this like new technology emerges, but the same kind of patterns of mistakes, same kind of misconfigurations, same kind of everything that they did in the previous iteration of new things.
Well, if DNS serves as any example, they'll still be getting it wrong in 30 years, so it's okay.
Always DNS. Yeah. It's always DNS.
What about you? What do you think are some of the more interesting things that you've pulled out?
Yeah, we've seen a lot of companies trying to add AI to their offerings. And in some cases, at least from my personal perspective, it feels forced. And in many other cases, it's the most amazing use of LLMs and AI that we can have and see. But with time, I believe that some of those forced use cases are going to tend to disappear.
Yeah, I definitely, I'm not going to call anybody out, but there are a handful of companies over the last 6 months that have actually fully rebranded to AI companies. Mm-hmm. And
well,
that
not
is,
doing anything real with AI.
Yeah, well, and so you weren't alive then, but during the dot, it's like during the dot-com boom, mm-hmm. right? Like
and blockchain also, like at some point in time, we were, everyone wanted to use blockchain, but actually a relational database was going to solve the same issue.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, and I always, like, I lament the fact that something monetary was what that ended up being used for, because I always thought that blockchain was going to be, like, fundamentally groundbreaking for distributed compute. Like, mm-hmm. I have all these smart devices in my house that each have some level of compute, like, send high-latency transactions to me and use my house as a mini data center. Mm-hmm. But no, we'd rather make meme coins and...
and rug pours.
Yeah. All right, so we're gearing up for DEF CON next, and that is one of my favorite conferences, because because that's where the real hackers are and where you learn about, you know, the kid, the mischievous kids, like the someone kids on this set who do who are trying to break things. So you guys have actually been trying to break some things lately, and I know you've released some research on hacking AI and the things that you've learned from that. So do you want to give us like a high level overview of what that research was?
During the past, I think like a year or two, we started really diving into like this AI vulnerability research thing, like trying to figure out what it even means, right? Because like I said, everyone talks about it, no one finds it out.
Yeah.
So we started out by doing a lot of AI cloud services, like all these platforms that people use in order to host AI models, like Hugging Face and Replicate and all these kind of platforms that all the big players use to host their models. And we were able to do malicious model attacks, deploy malicious models into the platform, and then move laterally and figure out how to access all the other customers, private models and data sets and everything. We're talking about real customers, right? Like OpenAI and XAI and Google and Meta. Everyone uses these platforms. So this was like the first iteration of this. And then the second iteration of this, which is like the newest iteration of this, is all the things that are AI infrastructure, all the open source projects that everyone builds AI on. Mm-hmm. What we presented, me and I just presented right now at Black Hat, was a research that we did on a library developed by NVIDIA, an NVIDIA open source library. We found a container escape vulnerability. Every container built with this library, we were able to escape out of. And the thing is that every single cloud provider was vulnerable to this. Everyone builds their stuff on top of this library. So this is like one vulnerability to hack every single cloud provider. This is just one example, right? This is what we found. What else are people gonna find?
And the impact is huge, because once you can escape the container, you have access to the workloads for other tenants that are running inside the same host.
Load balancers.
And potentially you can also do privilege escalation on the network and get access to the cluster. If it's a Kubernetes cluster, you can get access to that. And we were able to prove exactly this scenario on a couple of vendors. And those were our new case studies that we showed at Black Hat.
Wow. And so this is probably something that I think one of the sentiment changes I saw, you know, from last year to this year is this kind of, okay, everybody in our enterprise is going to be using AI whether we want them to or not, and we need to shift from security is always the no team, right? To the, hey, we noticed that you just spun this thing up. You know, maybe here are some best practices to secure these workloads. And that's, I think I've seen this kind of shift. And I think it's a positive thing, because historically, what's kept security teams from being as effective as they could is not necessarily the most healthy relationship with the rest of the enterprise and their internal customers, right? So I think we're almost forcing security teams to be better diplomats now to secure AI, because if you tell people you can't use it, they're just going to use it on their personal device. And you can't monitor data exfiltration that somebody looking at their work laptop and typing into their phone, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that we need to adopt a more open-minded approach as security professionals. So in your research, the NVIDIA container escape, for example, that is somewhere with NVIDIA, there's an inherent trust there, right? And so you can almost weaponize that trust, because to your point, it's become very ubiquitous because it's a very large company. So how do you think about that from a security perspective, the balance between just inherently trusting proven companies and technology and understanding that even those companies are not always getting it right?
Right. So like you said, NVIDIA is ubiquitous, right? Yeah. Everyone uses NVIDIA. But this is how we got this research, really, is we started thinking, okay, what's the one common denominator between all those AI providers and AI workloads and like steps in AI development? And the one common denominator is NVIDIA. They're always there. Everything runs on NVIDIA GPUs. Everyone uses these NVIDIA libraries to work with NVIDIA GPUs. So once we figured that out, the steps were almost simple, right?
Yeah.
So I think that it's good, right? It means that there's innovation and NVIDIA is building great products, but also at the same time, nothing can be trusted blindly, right?
Yeah.
So the NVIDIA security team were very responsive. They fixed those issues. And as long as you kept your infrastructure up to date.
Everybody does that.
Right.
Immediately. Everybody patches right away.
This
Everybody
importance,
updates right,
right?
away.
It's important updates.
I'm not sure. But yeah.
I'm not sure that's true, but but you should. You should patch.
Yeah. One of the difficulties, I think, is so I actually came into security through data science. So I went to a data science boot camp. They taught me how to write Python. Mm-hmm. And it was basically like, open your Jupyter notebook, import and install anything you could possibly think of that you may ever want to use. Mm-hmm. And then nobody ever told me not to hard code API keys. Yeah. Nobody ever told me not to. There were so many things, like I didn't even know that typo squatting was a thing. It's like if you can pip install it, it's safe. You know, so I think like there's this conflict between everybody's trying to use these things, vibe coding and all these things, and I think every CEO out there is drooling over the potential for exponential growth and exponential acceleration of productivity, but there's this flip side, right? So
yeah. I believe that the flip side here, I believe, is maturity. So we have Apache, we have Nginx for 2 decades now. And all of the vulnerabilities, or most of the vulnerabilities and trivial bugs that were in that software were already discovered, fixed, and patched.
Yeah.
NVIDIA Container Toolkit and many other software components, infrastructure components that are used for AI have 2 years, three, maybe four. So they still need to mature a lot, and they keep adding features at a rate that is incredible. It's great for product development, it's not great for security. Yeah. But at some point, when those all of those components mature, we're going to have a much safer AI space. Yeah.
So I know your job is not to give CISO advice, but if I'm listening to this, you know, and I'm a CISO of, say, a mid-market company, right? I don't have a seven-figure security budget. What are the first couple things that you think people leading security teams should be thinking about with regard to these types of vulnerabilities? Obviously, keeping up with patching and updating is important, but beyond that, are there like the first couple things you would think of that start here because this is the most basic hygiene?
So I would say that one of the things that's really important to keep in mind is that this is experimental technology, right? Like it's the innovation is in a insane rate. I don't think we've ever seen any innovation in any field that's so fast.
Yeah.
Like I think GPT-5 came out like an hour ago, right?
Yeah. I know. One of the colleagues was like, "Hey, did you read the news about GPT-5?" I'm like, "Dude, I had 6 shots of espresso and ran here with my hair on fire. I haven't read anything."
Literally fresh off the press.
Yeah.
So everything is going on so fast. All these people are innovating it into incredible levels of everything, really. And it's important to keep in mind that this is still in the experimental phase, right? It's still very new. These versions come up so fast, and people are coming up with new technologies so fast. Like a couple of months ago, it was MCPs. Now people are talking about agentic AI, and it's like the cycle is so fast. So while it is important to keep up with this new technology, it's important also to keep in mind that it is experimental. Mm-hmm. Mistakes are going to happen. People move fast and break things, right?
Yeah.
So it's important to isolate, right? To figure out if this use case, if I should plug that in, plug this new experimental technology into the most sensitive part of my environment, right? Mm-hmm. If I should maybe isolate it better, try to figure out the use cases, try to figure out how to isolate this very new experimental shiny new thing and isolate it from my important stuff.
So give people safe places to do risky things.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The basics are still very important. I'm going to implement this MCP. Should it be exposed to the internet? Yes, no. That's a question that in many scenarios, people don't ask themselves. Mm-hmm. And they are going to ask the same question for an API or for a web server when they are doing the implementation of those. And I think that the basic is, if you do infrastructure security well, you're going to cover 80% of what can go wrong with AI implementations inside the company. And something similar happens with employees using LLMs to do their work every day. If you already have some kind of solution that's going to prevent data leaks, most likely that solution is going to also be able to intercept the traffic to the LLM provider, and you should have that.
All right, so unfortunately the answer is go back to the basics and maybe make sure you are already doing things correctly, because that'll solve a lot of these issues.
Not a very sexy answer, right?
Yeah, no, I mean it's not, but I think unfortunately that's the reality. Like the majority of breaches we see, like the amount of times we see things that are just 100% bad security hygiene, you know, employees reusing personal passwords that have been stolen at work, and like humans are fallible people and agents are fallible things too. So I think, you know, it's not a great answer, but Wiz can help, I assume. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you know, luckily you have expertise. And that's the other thing I think that for me is huge is security teams. We've done multiple surveys that show that the smaller a company is, the more likely they are to think they should manage their own security, which is bizarre and kind of counterintuitive, but I think they feel like they don't need to hire an outside function because I'm just a blah. And mm-hmm. It used to be that like if you're not huge, no, you're not going to be a target. But these days where you can automate attacks, everybody's a target because you're just crawling to find open anything, right, mm-hmm. where you can get in. So for me, it also goes back to just the kind of you need to be aware of the fact that it's not just if, it's a when, because the rate of change in attackers has also been exponentially increased. And we were just talking to Cloudflare yesterday where they're like, they'll just get in and you're just on a list of places that have already been compromised. You don't know it. And it's just a fact of, you know, waiting for them to get to you on the list. So mm-hmm. call in professionals because you can't scale your 3-person security team when things catch on fire and still do the day-to-day work of your security team. So mm-hmm. call in professionals like Wiz, call in your MSPs, call in your MSSPs and ask for help because you really need it.
Yeah, true, right. Like I think obviously security products should always be the way you trust the security, but also I think that the importance of collaborating with like security researchers, whether it's, you know, the big ones have bug bounty programs, but even if you're a small company that couldn't have it, you should still be open to receiving reports from, mm-hmm. you know, good people yeah. who want to say, hey, this is, you have like an open Jupyter notebook, you have this thing, you have that thing, oops. Right? You should take care of it.
Yeah.
So yeah, not a lot of small companies have that mindset in mind, right? And then when they don't have that mindset, that the first person to report it to them will want extortion money instead of saying, hey, I'm yeah. a good guy, you should fix this.
Yeah. Hmm. Awesome. Well, unfortunately, we're out of time. I would love to go longer, but Hillai, Andres, thank you so much for joining us. We would love to have you back again. This is great.
Thank you.
Thanks. For theCUBE, I'm Jackie McGuire. We'll be back shortly with more interviews and amazing content from Black Hat 2025 at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. Stay tuned.